Hello students, myself Deepthi Goyal. So today we shall discuss the Gamow's theory of alpha decay. As we have studied the alpha decay spectra, where it consisted of closely spaced lines of alpha particles, where the energies of the alpha particles were differing for a very small amount, and the classical mechanics could not explain how the potential barrier could be crossed by a 5 to 11 mega electron volt carrying alpha particle where the height was 26 mega electron volts. So classical mechanics was not able to describe how the alpha particle or how the alpha particle could be coming out of the nucleus, or alpha decay could take place from the nucleus. So Gamow gave a theory based on the quantum mechanics where he explained the alpha decay. So in his theory of alpha decay particle, he made following assumptions. He proposed that alpha decay exists as an entity. It exists as a substructure, as an entity within a heavy nucleus, and alpha particle is in constant motion. It is constantly moving and is surrounded by a potential barrier, as that the nuclear wall of the nucleus is acting as a potential barrier which the alpha particle has to cross for coming out of the nucleus. And the third assumption was that there is a small, very small probability but definite likelihood that the particle may pass through the barrier. Means there is a small, very small, a little probability that it will pass through the barrier at the time when the alpha particle substructure will collide with the wall of the nucleus. So on this assumptions, Gamow was able to show the existence of the alpha decay. He was able to prove that alpha decay took place in the radioactivity. So what he did, he considered a one-dimensional potential barrier of a width delta. As you can see here, this we have drawn a potential barrier. The potential barrier is having a width of delta, that x is equal to 0 to x is equal to delta. This is the width of the potential barrier, and the potential barrier is having a height of u. Okay, height u means it is carrying a potential energy of u height. Let a particle is incident on this barrier. So we assume that the alpha particle is hitting, it is incident on the barrier with energy, means the alpha particle is carrying energy E, and this energy E is less than the height of the potential barrier. So the particle is incident on the barrier with a height less than the barrier height, and the potential V is the potential V. What is the potential V on the alpha particle? The potential V, where it is not inside the potential barrier of width delta, so it is assumed that in region 1 and in this region 3, the potential experienced by the alpha particle is 0. Okay, it is 0, it is not having any potential, it is not experiencing any potential. The potential is 0 in the region 1 and in the region 3. But when it goes into the potential barrier, here it has some potential. So the potential experienced in the region 2 will be equal to the barrier height. So the potential energy will be equal to the barrier height energy, that is U, in the region 2. So classical dynamics was not able to predict how the alpha particle could enter. If it is entering, this is a nuclear wall, if it has entered this region 2, then how it could escape this potential barrier, how it could cross this barrier and then come out of the potential well or the potential height. So the Gamow was able to predict how it came out. So he said that if we assume that a alpha particle is a wave, so if it is a wave, if it is a particle, it by the प्रिंसिपल ऑफ द वेव पार्टिकल दैट द पार्टिकल विच पोजेस द कैरेक्टरिस्टिक्स ऑफ द वेव एज वेल एज द पार्टिकल एज प्रपोज बाय डी ब्रॉगली. सो वी से दैट दिस अल्फा पार्टिकल हैविंग लेसर एनर्जी इज इंसिडेंट ऑन द वॉल. सो देर वुड बी प्रॉबिबिलिटी दैट इट विल स्ट्राइक द वॉल और इट वुड बी गेट रिफ्लेक्टेड. So there is probability that the alpha particle is striking the wall and it could enter the barrier height or it could get reflected from the wall of the barrier height. So this is the incident wave and this is the reflected wave. So if it is incident and it gets transmitted inside the barrier height, so what happens that the wave instead of getting transmitted, it here gets refracted. So when it gets it refracted, the energy becomes little less. So its energy is reduced and is refracted. And again when it strikes the other barrier height at x is equal to delta, again if this is the incident wave now, there is again a probability that it would get reflected again and there is a probability that it will get transmitted. Okay? So when it gets transmitted here or when it gets reflected, so we have the probability that the alpha particle will tunnel through the barrier height of u. Is that clear? That there is a tunneling effect on the alpha particle where this tunneling causes the alpha particle to enter into a nucleus or it is coming out of the nucleus, it is decaying as an alpha particle from the nucleus. So the tunneling effect is responsible. So we shall calculate in this that is there any transmission coefficient value is there or not. If there is certain transmission coefficient value, then definitely the alpha particle will be tunneling through the potential barrier and is responsible for the alpha decay. So what we see here, that we have a three regions 1, 2 and 3 where here the potential width is from x is equal to 0 to x is equal to delta and the height of the potential width is u. The value of the V is 0 in the first region and in the third region where the value of V is equal to u. And obviously the energy carried by the alpha particle is always less than the barrier height. Okay, the energy carried by the alpha particle is always less than the barrier height. If it was more than the value of the barrier height, then classically also we could say that the alpha particle could have crossed the nucleus and it would have decayed. But the question is here that the alpha particle is not having enough energy as compared to the potential barrier. So how it can cross the potential barrier? So always remember that E is less than U, where E is the energy carried by the alpha particle. So the energy carried by the alpha particle is less than the barrier height. Okay. So we shall consider the Schrödinger wave equation for all the three regions. So consider, we know that the Schrödinger wave equation in the one dimensional is written as d square psi upon dx square plus 2m by h cross square e minus v psi. Everybody is familiar with this Schrödinger wave equation. Let us give that equation number 1. Now when we consider this first region, in the first region we know that this v is equal to 0. So when we put the value of v equal to 0 here, the equation becomes d square psi by dx square plus 2m by h cross square e psi is equal to 0. So, we can get the solution of this Schrödinger wave equation. This is a quadratic equation. So, the solution of the quadratic equation is given by A e ki power iota k1x plus B e ki power minus k1x. This is the differential equation, second order differential equation. So, the value of the solution is A e ki power iota k1x plus B e ki power minus k1x. Where the first part of this solution is representing the incident wave, which is incident, okay, on the wall of the barrier. So this is the incident alpha particle and if it reflects back, the negative component of the exponential will be giving the reflection component. So the b e ki power minus iota k1 x, the second term is representing the reflected wave that would have reflected from the boundary. It would not been allowed to enter the boundary and therefore it is reflected. So the first part, this first equation, first part of the equation represents the incident alpha particle wave, and the second part represents the reflected wave, where this k1 constant is given by 2m e upon h square ka under root. So it is under root of 2me by h cross square. So now we have considered the first region. So now we consider the third region. Also in the third region, what is there? In the third region also the potential V is again equal to 0. So again substituting the value of V equal to 0, we get the same type of equation here also. And we know that the particle which is incident here is coming out here from the third region. So both will have the same constants, that is k1. So the equation that is coming out of the third equation, the solution of the Schrodinger wave equation will be given for the third equation, third region, as psi 3, and psi 3 will be c3, which is again a constant e ki power iota k1x, because both the particles are same in the first and the second region, and both are being the same particle is being transmitted in the third region if we suppose that the transmission takes place. So we have e to the power iota k1x, and this represents the forward transmitted wave. So this is the incident wave, this one was the reflected wave, and in the third region there is only transmission, there is no boundary for it to be get reflected. So this reflected part is not there in the third region, there is only a transmitted wave which is in the forward direction. Okay students, so next we consider the second region. So in region 2 we know that V value, that is the potential, is having a value of the barrier height. So we have to substitute V is equal to U, and also we know that the energy carried by the alpha particle is less than the U, that is the barrier height. So we have substituted here V is equal to U. So we get E minus of U. And since E is less than U, so negative term is dominant here. So we take negative common here. So we get d square psi by dx square minus 2m by h cross square U minus E psi equal to 0. So this is again a differential equation, second order differential equation. Now we know how the solution has to be carried out. So the solution is given by, instead of exponential term with a complex term, here we have exponential terms. So we have psi 2 is equal to e ki power minus k2x, and another term e ki power plus k2x, where the first term b e ki power minus k2x is the refracted wave that will get refracted. There will be a bending of the wave and it would get refracted through the barrier, and the refracted wave when touches the other side of the barrier, it could get reflected. So the first part is representing the refracted wave, and the second part is representing the reflected wave that could be reflected from the other wall of the barrier. So reflected wave by the other side of the barrier, and d e ki power minus k2x is the refracted wave through the barrier. So we have now five constants A, B, C, D and E. And here, because there is some change in the value, because here it is 2m upon h cross u minus e, so the k2 value is here given as 2m u minus e by h cross square under root, where the k1 was simply 2me by h cross square. Okay, so there is a difference, that k1 and k2 is differing by an amount of u minus e here in the equation. So now we have to calculate the five constants A, B, C, D and E. So these constants can be calculated by using the boundary conditions. So where is the boundary? The first boundary is at this. This is the first boundary experienced at x is equal to 0 distance. And the second boundary is experienced at the second barrier wall, that is at x is equal to delta distance. So we shall be taking the two boundary conditions, where the boundary condition states that if here the wave function is having the value of psi 1 in the first, here it is having value of psi 2 here, and here the wave function is having value psi 3. So at this boundary x is equal to 0, psi 1 will be equal to psi 2 at x is equal to 0. And similarly at this boundary, the wave function psi 2 at x is equal to delta will be equal to psi 3 at x equal to delta. Okay, so at the boundary, what will happen, that at x is equal to 0, both the wave functions psi 1 and psi 2 will be equal, and at the boundary x is equal to delta, both the wave functions psi 2 and psi 3 will be equal, and similarly the derivatives at the boundaries. Okay, so from these four boundary conditions, we can evaluate the constants. Okay, since there are 5 and we have 4 boundary conditions, so 4 constants can be calculated in terms of the 5th constant. So what we have, so we apply the boundary condition. So when we apply the boundary condition, our first boundary condition is that psi 1 at x is equal to 0 is equal to psi 2 at x is equal to 0. So here it was from equation number 3, when we substitute x equal to 0 here. So what happens, anything raised to power 0 is 1. So this exponential becomes 1, this exponential becomes 1. So what we get here as psi 1 will be giving a plus b. And this equation is equal to psi 2. So psi 2 at x is equal to 0, when again we put x equal to 0 here, again the exponential term becomes 1. So we get d plus e. So psi 1 at x equal to 0 is equal to psi 2 at x is equal to 0 gives the equation a plus b is equal to d plus e. And the boundary condition is also valid for the first order derivative. So when we take the first order derivative of d psi 1 by dx is equal to d psi 2 by dx at x is equal to 0. So when we take the derivative with respect to x, so what will be here, we will get y iota iota k1 in the numerator, and here we will get minus iota k1 in the numerator. So iota k1 can get common. So we will get a minus b, and since we have to put the value of x equal to 0, so again the exponential term becomes 1. So here we have iota k1 a minus b. Similarly, if we put here, what we will have, we get minus k2 here down and here plus k2. So taking k2 common, so we will get minus k2 d minus e. Okay, so we get minus k2 d minus e. Similarly, when we put the substitutions for at the x equal to delta boundary, so what we get, psi 2 at x is equal to delta is equal to psi 3 at x equal to delta. Similarly, we have to just substitute here, x equal to delta here, x equal to delta here, x equal to delta here. So we get d e ki power minus k2 delta plus e ki power minus k2 delta is equal to c e ki power iota k1 delta. So we get this equation. And when we put the first order derivative equal both for the second wave function and the third wave function at x equal to delta, so we get what? We get this term, we get minus k2 is coming out, we get d e ki power minus k2 delta, and minus k2 is taken out, so we get a negative sign in front of e, we get minus e ki power k2 delta, which is equal to derivative of psi 3 with respect to x, we get iota k1 in the front. So we get iota k1 c e ki power iota k1 delta. So this minus k2 can be taken here downside in the denominator. So we get d e ki power minus k2 delta minus of e ki power k2 delta is equal to minus. So here is minus iota k1 by k2 c e ki power k1 delta. So now what we do? Now we add and subtract both the equations. So we have two equations, we have this equation and we have this equation. So you can see here, if we remove this equation, so we can see here that you have d e ki power iota minus k2 delta and we have d e ki power minus k2 delta. So when we add the two equations, so here it is a plus e ki power e k2 delta and here is minus. So plus and minus gets cancelled. So you get 2d e ki power minus k2 delta, which is equal to c e ki power iota k1 delta is common in both the terms. So you get 1 minus iota k1 upon k2. Similarly, subtracting the two equations, our D term will get cancelled and we get the E term. So we get 2E, e ki power k2 delta is equal to C e ki power k1 delta upon 1 plus iota. Because when you subtract, this minus sign will get plus. So we get 1 plus iota k1 upon k2. So now we have added and subtracted this equation. So we got 2D value here and 2E value this. So taking the 2 to the other side, we get D is equal to C by 2 e ki power iota k1 delta 1 minus iota k1 by k2 e ki power e k2 delta, and E value is this term, that is C by 2 e ki power iota k1 delta 1 plus iota k1 upon k2 e ki power minus k2 delta. So now we will be substituting the values of these D and E, that is equation number 13 and 14, in equation number 9 and 10. So here we have the equation 9, a plus b is equal to d plus e, and iota k1 a minus b is equal to minus k2 d minus e. So when we substitute the value of d plus e and d minus e here, what we will get, we will calculate a plus b and a minus b, and then by adding and subtracting both a plus b and a minus b, we can calculate the value of a and b. So we get a plus b is equal to d plus e. So just simply adding the two equations, you get c by 2 e ki power iota k1 delta is common. So e ki power k by 2 is multiplied with the bracketed term. So you get e ki power k2 delta and e ki power minus k2 delta. These are added. And here you have minus iota k1 by k2 is common. So you get e ki power k2 delta. Minus is common. So from here you get a negative sign. So you get e ki power k2 delta minus e ki power minus k2 delta. Taking this two term to both the bracketed terms here. So what is this term? So this term is nothing but the hyperbolic cos, that is the cos of k2 delta, and this is hyperbolic sine, that is sine of k2 delta. So in this way we are able to calculate a plus b is equal to this term. So this term is represented by the equation number 15. Similarly, we can calculate a minus b. So a minus b here was minus k2 upon iota k1 d minus b. So it is minus k2 upon iota k1, and here we have substituted the value of d minus e. Again, c by 2 e ki power iota k1 delta is common. You get e ki power k by 2 minus of e ki power minus k by 2 minus k2 delta, and with minus iota k1 by k2 common. Again, minus minus will be plus, so here is a plus sign. So you get minus iota k1 by k2 e ki power k2 delta plus e ki power minus k2 delta. So what we get, now we multiply this minus k2 upon iota k1 with the two terms, where this minus k2 iota k1 gets cancelled with this term, and we get a plus sign because minus minus will be plus. And when you are multiplying this term with this term, then 1 upon iota will be minus iota, and minus minus will be plus. So we get e ki power k2 delta plus e ki power minus k2 delta upon 2, and we get a plus iota k2 upon k1 c e ki power k2 delta minus e ki power minus k2 delta by 2. So again, this term is what? This term is cos of k2 delta. You get iota k2 upon k1, and this term is hyperbolic sine, that is sine of k2 delta. So this term is a minus of b of cos of k2 delta plus iota k2 by k1 sine of k2 delta. So this is equation number 16. So now again, adding and subtracting equation 15 and 16, we can calculate the value of a and b. So now by adding and subtracting a plus b and a minus b equation, what we get? We get a is equal to c e ki power iota k1 delta. So here you can see when we add 15 and equation 16, so c e ki power iota k1 delta is common. So this is common. So when you add, you get cos k2 delta and cos k2 delta, that is 2 cos delta. And here also you get 2a. So 2 is cancelled. So you get cos of k2 delta, and the 2 of the a will come to the second term in the denominator. You get iota by 2. Here it is k2 by k1, and here it is k1 by k2. So taking plus iota by 2, we get k2 by k1 because with plus it is k2 by k1 and with minus it is k1 by k2. So it is iota by 2 k2 by k1 minus k1 by k2 sine of k2 delta. Okay, is that clear? So now for b, we shall be subtracting the two equations. So when we get b is equal to minus iota c by 2 e to power iota k1 delta and cos cos gets cancelled. So you get k1 by k2 plus k2 by k1 sine of k2 delta. So these are the equation number 17 and 18 for the values of a and b. So now we have already discussed that when we consider the potential, this was the first region, this was the second region and this was the third region. So we have the alpha particle tunneled through the barrier and it escaped out, it transmitted in the third region. So we have to check whether the alpha particle decay is there or not. So we have to check the transmission, whether the alpha transmission is taking place in the third region or not. So we have to calculate the transmission coefficient. So the transmission coefficient T is given by transmission probability density current upon the incident probability density current. That is the ratio of the probability density current to of the transmission to the probability density current that was incident. So in this way we can, if we get the value of transmission coefficient, if there is any value, means there is a possibility of the alpha decay, and the alpha decay would not be explained classically, it is explained quantum mechanically by the tunneling process. So the transmission coefficient T is given by V3, where V is the velocity of the alpha particle that is being transmitted in the third region, into psi T star, where probability density is always given by the psi into psi star. And incident was having the velocity V1, so V1 into psi incident star. So now we know that the when they are tunneling, it does not affect the velocities. We assume that the velocity in the of alpha particle in region 1 and in the region 3 are both same. So V1 is equal to V3, so V1, V3 gets cancelled. Okay, so V1, V3 will get cancelled out. So you get psi t into psi t star upon V psi incident upon psi incident star. So you must be remembering that in equation 3 you had two solutions of psi 1. First was the incident and second was the reflected. So we are taking only the incident part wave function. So psi incident was a e to power iota k1x. And psi transmitted had in the third region, we had only one component of the solution of the third equation, that was the psi transmitted only, because in the third region there is no boundary to reflect back the wave. So psi transmitted was given by c e to power iota k1x. So we shall be substituting the value of psi incident and psi transmitted in the transmission coefficient value. So you get c into c star e to power iota k1x e to power minus iota k1x, because when we have psi star, we have to take the conjugate of the complex function. So complex conjugate means we have changed the iota with minus iotas. So we get a into a star e to power iota k1x into e to power minus iota k1x. So these gets cancelled, you are left out with just the constant cc star upon aa star. Already you have equation number 17 here. So from equation number 17, for a is represented in equation number c. So since a is represented in terms of c, we can substitute the value of a and a star. So when we put the conjugate of a star, what will happen here? Exponential iota will be changed to e to the power minus iota. And here a plus iota b type term will be changed to a minus iota b for its complex conjugate. So what you get? Cc star e to power iota k1 delta e to power minus iota k1 delta. Cos of this term remains the same for the c a equation, and for a star you get cos k2 delta minus iota by 2 k2 by k1 minus k1 by k2 sine of k2 delta. So this term is nothing but this is just a plus b into a minus b. So a plus b into a minus b is what? It is a square minus b square. So when you do a square minus b square, you will get iota square. So iota square is what? Iota square is minus 1. So minus minus will again get plus. So when we simplify, this gets cancelled. Cos into cos will be cos square. So you get cos square k2 delta, and iota square will be, I told you, minus 1, and there is minus sign, so there is minus minus plus. Half and half square will be 1 by 4. You get k2 upon k1 minus k1 by k2 ka whole square into sine square of k2 delta. And we know that cos square k2 delta is 1 plus sine square k2 delta. So substitute the value of k, cos square k2 delta is 1 plus sine square k2 delta here. And then sine square k2 delta will come out. With some small calculations, we can simplifications, we can say that t is 1 upon 1 plus k2 square plus k1 square upon 2 k1 k2 ka whole square into sine square of k2 delta. Substitute the value of k1 and k2 in the transmission equation. So what was the equation? That t was 1 upon 1 plus k1 square plus k2 square upon 2 k1 k2 ka whole square into sine square of under root 2 m u minus e upon h square into delta. So k1 is 2 m e upon h square and k2 is 2 m u minus e by h square. So on squaring it, the under root gets cancelled, and in the numerator term you can see that 2 m e by h square and 2 m e by h square gets cancelled. So you are left out with 2 m u upon h square. And in the denominator you get 2m gets come out of the under root. You get under root of u minus e into under root e, and here h4 comes to be h square, and there is a whole square. So you get sine square 2m u minus e by h cross into delta, where this is the k2 value. So on simplification, 2m gets cancelled, h square gets cancelled. So you get 1 plus, there is a whole square also, you get 1 plus u square upon 4 e into u minus e sine square of under root 2 m u minus e by h cross into delta, where this denominator term has been taken to the numerator and there is a minus 1 in the exponent. So now what we know? We know that k2 delta is greater than 1. So if k2 delta is greater than 1, then sine square k2 delta is equal to 1 by 4 e to the power 2 k2 delta. So how this is possible? We know that sine of k2 delta is written as e to the power k2 delta minus e to the power minus k2 delta by 2. So this can be simplified as e raised to power 2 k2 delta minus 1 upon 2 e to the power k2 delta. Now we know that e to the power k2 delta was greater than 1. So this e to the power k2 delta will always be greater than 1. So this negative sign, negative 1, can be neglected. So we can equate it as e to the power 2 k2 delta upon 2 e to the power k2 delta. So 1 e to the power k2 delta gets cancelled. You are left out with e to the power k2 delta by 2. And here it was sine square k2 delta. So squaring this term, you get e to the power 2 k2 delta by 4. So substitute the value of sine k2 delta as 1 by 4 e to the power 2 k2 delta in this equation. So you get t will be equal to 1 plus u square upon 4e u minus e. For this term you write e to the power 2 k2 delta by 4 raised to the power minus 1. Now again this term is greater than 1. So 1 can again be neglected. So we get, and there is a negative minus 1 also, you get u square upon 4 into 4 16 e u minus e e to the power k2 delta raised to the power minus 1. So on reciprocaling it, we get 16 e u minus e upon u square e to the power minus 2 k2 delta. So taking 1 u with the u minus e term, you get 16 e upon u 1 minus e by u e to the power minus 2 k2 delta. So this is the final equation of the transmission coefficient. Also we know that transmission coefficient means that it would be the same probability in which it would decay. The alpha particle is decaying. So it is the probability decay per unit time. And the decay per unit time is represented by lambda, that is a decay constant. So instead of T, we write here as lambda. So lambda is equal to 16 e by u 1 minus e by u e to the power minus 2 k2 lambda. Now for further simplification, we take the log on the both the sides. So we can write this as log lambda is equal to log of exponential we have. So this minus 2k2 will come in the numerator. So you get minus 2k2 lambda and log of E is 1. So you get minus 2k2 lambda plus log of 16 E by U 1 minus E by U. Also we know that the E value, that is the energy carried by the alpha particle, is less than the barrier height. So if E is less than U, therefore E by U can be neglected in comparison to 1. So we are left out with only 16 E by U term. So here we come, log lambda is equal to minus 2k2 lambda plus log of 16 E by U. So substitute the value of again k2. So log lambda is equal to minus 2k2 lambda, 2k2 delta plus log of 16 E by U is equal to, when we put the value of k2, we get minus 2 under root of 2 m U minus E by h cross delta plus log 16 E by U. So we can say here, by putting h is equal to h upon 2 pi, we get minus 4 pi by h under root of 2 m U minus E under root delta plus log 16 E by U. So this is the final relation. So but we know that the U is not constant. It changes with the distance r according to Coulomb's law. So we have to do a slight modification in the first part of this relation. So this first part can be written as minus 4 pi by h integral r naught to infinity 2m under root 2m u minus e into dr, where the integral is a function of the distance r. Now so substitute this integral over here in the equation number 20, you get log lambda is equal to log 16 e by u minus 4 pi by h integral from the initial radius r naught to infinity under root 2m u minus e dr. So this final relation is a relation that is a relation between the decay constant and the kinetic energy. So and this also proves that there is some probability of tunneling or transmission of the alpha decay from one region to another region, or it is decaying in the nucleus, alpha decay is taking place. And we have successfully proved that the alpha particles of lower energy is able to come out of the nucleus. It is able to pass the potential barrier, which is having a greater height than its own energy, and the alpha decay is possible for lower energy. So it explains the emission of alpha particle of lower energy than the energy of potential barrier. So Gamow's theory was successful in explaining the alpha decay, where classically we could not explain how alpha particles of lower energy could be emitted out of the nucleus. So I hope that you have understood this alpha decay process. Meet you again. Thank you.